Good morning, Woodland Baptist Church. He is risen.
He is risen.
There we go. I love it. I love it. That is an ancient Easter greeting. And the best source, the one I like the most, it comes from Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, these disciples are all moaning and grumbling about how the world has been turned upside down and everything they had hoped for had been done away with because Jesus is dead. And then some dude shows up and starts talking to them. And then he goes through the scripture and he says everything that happened was already foretold and what has been handed down from generation to generation. And then he sits down, he eats with them, and he breaks bread. And then they can see, they're like, oh my goodness, it's Jesus. He's alive. He is risen. And then they run back to the disciples and they say to the disciples in a room in Jerusalem, they say, he is truly risen. He is risen indeed. That's what we're celebrating this morning. So everybody, let's stand up together and let's sing Christ is risen.
Oh, praise.
Take a seat. We'll take this opportunity to welcome you all to worship at Woodland Baptist Church. And again, one of the most glorious days in the whole year. Every single one of you has a birthday, right? Every single one of you has a birthday. But this is the greatest birthday, because this is the day that human beings were born from the grave. And when we trust in Christ, we have been, as Ephesians 2 says, we have been raised up with him. Trust in Jesus, and today is your birthday. That is the proclamation of the gospel. So we'll take this opportunity, too, to shape our minds and shape our worship with Scripture. And we'll take a look at Psalm 33. And what's neat about Psalm 33 is verse 1 starts off saying, sing to the Lord, sing to the Lord. And you are all fulfilling Scripture right there. You are all being obedient to Psalm 1. And then it goes on and it explains what in the world we're singing to the Lord for. He's created all things. And in verse 11 it says, the counsel of the Lord stands forever. The plans of his heart from generation to generation. Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he has chosen to be his own possession. Okay. Who is the nation of the Lord? It is you who trust in Jesus. It's not Israel. It's not the United States. It's not some other country. It's all of us gathered here proclaiming the name of the Son. And look what it says in 13. It says, the Lord looks down from heaven. He observes everyone. His gaze on all the inhabitants of the earth from his dwelling place. And he forms the hearts of all of them. He considers all their works. A king is not saved by a large army. A warrior will not be rescued by great strength. The horse is a false hope for safety. It provides no escape by its great power. In other words, there will be nothing that saves you from the grave and from your sins other than the power of the Lord. But look, the Lord keeps his eyes on those who fear him, those who depend on his faithful love to rescue them from death and to keep them alive in famine. We wait for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our hearts rejoice in him because he trusts in his holy name. We trust in his holy name. May your faithful love rest on us, Lord, for we put our hope in you, the great name of Jesus. So we're going to continue worship by allowing the choir to sing the gospel to you. And then before the sermon, we'll all stand again in worship and sing one more song before the sermon is preached. I hope y'all enjoy.
Thank you.
the scripture we read previously, y'all come on down. It talked about God's faithful love. We see God's faithful love in the cross. We see him ascend on high above all of creation. And the whole work of creation is summed up in redemption, in that we were once sinners, dead in our sins and our trespasses. We once rebelled from God, but he faithfully pursued his people and his creation to the point of death. And there in his death, we have life. And now he has ascended, we proclaim his holiness and his faithful love to all. That's what we're going to continue to do in worship. So if you would, let's stand and proclaim the holiness and the worthiness of King Jesus for his faithful love.
Holy, holy, holy.
Father, you stand above all. You know all things. You made all things. And through Jesus, our Savior, you sustain all things. Lord, we come to you today, and we thank you for the power of your Spirit. And Lord, we ask that your Spirit would move, breathe life into our dead bones, and that we would be made alive. That we would die to our sins, and that we would die to death and live the life that has been made in Christ. We give you all the glory in the name of King Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Well, happy Easter to you. Good to see you this morning. Take your Bibles, if you will, if you have a copy with you, and turn to the Gospel of John. If you don't have a copy, good news, the back of the seat in front of you, there's a copy of Scripture, looks like this. You can take that, you can use it this morning, and you can take it home with you. It's yours, you don't have to bring it back. You can have this if you want, if you need one, or if you just would like one, take it with you. And like Doritos, we can make more of those. So John chapter 20, we're going to look at in just a minute. And again, welcome and happy Easter to you. I don't know if you have any Easter traditions or you've had any Easter experiences in the past. For me, Easter, when I was growing up, was always the time that I got dressed up in the clothes that I never, ever wanted to wear at any other time. It was bad enough to have to wear church clothes on church day, but Easter became like super duper church clothes. And you had to be careful not to get them messed up until you got the picture taken. And so there was always this, don't move, don't touch anybody, don't be around anyone. Let's be very cautious getting into the car, out of the car, into the church, out of the church, back home again, get the picture taken, and then you can do what you want to do after that. So that may be your experience, and you may be sitting there right now trying to be careful that no one touches you and wrinkles your clothes up before a picture gets taken, and maybe your mom is going to yell at you if that happens. And so good luck with that is all I can say. And if you walk past and you look like you're trying to keep yourself from getting wrinkled up, I'm going to give you a big hug, and your mom will be okay, I promise you. But John chapter 20, and we're going to begin reading in verse 19. We'll read down through the end of the chapter. And as I read this passage of Scripture this morning, remember that what's being described is after Jesus has been crucified and buried, and the darkness that settled in has given way to light, and Jesus has been raised up from the dead, and some of his disciples have encountered him as the risen Lord. They've seen him, but they have not understood. They saw that he was alive, and they heard from him, but they weren't sure what was really going on. And it may very well be that for some of us, Easter is a time where we know something's happened, but maybe we don't know exactly what's going on. And the passage we're going to read kind of answers that question. What's really happening? What is Easter really about? And when this part of the story is recounted to us, there is this real sense of expectation for us that we would hear these words and receive these words, and that everything that Easter is intended to be would become true for us in the reading of these words. So I'll read them out loud, and you can read them silently where you are, and we'll hear what is the very word of God. When it was evening on that first day of the week, the disciples were gathered together with the doors locked because they feared the Jewish religious leaders. And Jesus came, and he stood among them, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." And having said this, he showed them his hands and his side. So the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And then Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And after saying this, he breathed on them, and he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. And if you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. And if you retain the sins of anyone, then they're retained." But Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. And so the other disciples were telling him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "If I don't see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger into the mark of those nails and put my hand into his side, then I'll never believe." A week later, the disciples were indoors again, and Thomas was with them. And even though the doors were locked, Jesus came and he stood among them and he said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Here, put your finger in my hands and look at them. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Don't be faithless, but instead believe. And so Thomas responded, my Lord, my God. And Jesus said, because you've seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet still believe. Now, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples that aren't written in this book. But those that are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So the first Easter, all right, Jesus has died. He's been raised up from the dead. It's in the early morning. And when some women come down to check out the tomb, they're coming to put some spices in the tomb. When they get there, the door's opened, right? So there's a big stone, big cave, just picture it. And the stone's been pushed out of the way in front of the cave, and so it's wide open. It would be like a funeral happens out in the cemetery, and you go the next day to kind of pay your respects, and all the dirt's been dug back up again, and the door's open, and you look down in the hole, and there's nobody in the hole. You would think this is a weird thing to have happened. And his disciples felt the same thing. This is strange. This is weird. I can't believe that he's not here. Now, mind you, Jesus has for 3 years told them this is going to happen. They just didn't believe it, all right? So if you ever feel like that maybe you've fallen short in believing and listening and hearing, it took 3 years of teaching, and Jesus' disciples still didn't remember that he promised them that he was going to come out of the grave. And so when those women went back and they told the other disciples of Jesus, hey, the tomb is empty. There's nobody there. The other disciples raced down there to see what was going on. Excuse me. And they got there and the exact same thing happened. Saw that the door was open. Saw that the tomb was empty. Saw that the swaddling clothes were laying there on the ground. And they thought, well, this is strange. I wonder what's happened. And somebody in the group said, you know, Jesus said he was going to be raised from the dead. I wonder if that's what happened. They thought, well, I don't know. I just can't believe that that was happening. So if for some reason on this Easter Sunday morning you're here and you're thinking, not really sure what's going on, not really sure what has happened, not what is going to happen, or even what is supposed to happen, you're in really good company. The first disciples of Jesus were confused and wondered the exact same thing. And so after all of this has happened, they got together and they put their heads together and they said, we better go hide out because the same people that killed Jesus may very well want to kill us. And they may be after us as well. And so they start out in this passage that we've just read, locked in a room, afraid, fear. Easter Sunday morning begins with a celebration of Jesus being raised from the dead. The angels rejoice. The disciples then are confused. And that confusion by the end of the day gives way to fear, as oftentimes happens. You know, when you don't know what's going on, when you're confused about what's happening, you oftentimes become afraid. I don't know about you, but I don't like to fly, right? Like, not fly, like jump off of the stage here, but fly in terms of being on an airplane. Don't like it. There are a number of reasons, perhaps, why. One of them is being in charge. You know what I mean? If I'm in the car and I'm riding and someone else is driving, I'm deathly afraid. And for some reason, it's like there's good reasons to be afraid when somebody else is driving. And so I want to drive. I want to be in charge. And Ginger sits over there. My wife, she hates to ride with me, but she always has just white knuckles and she's holding on. And I look over and I'm like, Ginger, why are you holding on to the door? And she says, well, you know, what if we end up in a ditch? And I'm like, holding on to the door isn't going to help you if we end up in a ditch. I can promise you that. But flying is something I get very scared of. I get very afraid of flying. And when I'm flying along, if you've ever been on an airplane and the airplane, you feel like you're hitting potholes, you know what I mean? Like the plane's bouncing around and you wonder, what's happening right now? And so I have learned years and decades of flying all of the time and hating it at every moment. I have learned the thing to do is to watch the flight attendants. Right, because as long as they're okay, they're like still wandering around and hobbling up and down the aisle and trying to give people their Coke Zero and that sort of thing. If they're doing that, then I feel like it's okay. I don't know what else is going on. But when you see them sit down, then you know, time to be afraid. If they're afraid, time to be afraid because they know, they understand. What happened here with the disciples can be true of us in our lives. If we don't understand, if we're confused about what's happening, if we are unsure of what either is going on at the moment or what is going to go on into the future, then we can live our lives with fear. The sense of uncertainty that leads to our being afraid. And in some ways, there's nothing wrong with being afraid. right? There are things of which we should be afraid. But when we come to understand and to know the truth, fear can sometimes be alleviated. And what these disciples needed to learn and what you and I need to discover is that even if our Easter Sunday begins with fear, even if there is a sense in which your life is filled with uncertainty and fear today, there is an answer to that fear. Now, what's interesting in this passage is the disciples were afraid, not that the weather was going to turn bad. They weren't afraid that they were going to get rained out. They weren't afraid that the cookout was not going to go on. What they were afraid of was the religious leaders. It's the religious leaders that had come after Jesus. They had opposed him from day one, as we have read earlier in the Gospels. They were against him from the moment he came along preaching. And the reason why is because Jesus came and proclaimed that people were made right with God, not by what they did, but who they believed in. That it wasn't their good works, it wasn't their religious duty, it wasn't their religious activity that made them right with God. It instead was God's good and gracious and kind work and their reception of that by placing their faith in him. Early in the Gospels, Jesus goes into his own hometown and he begins to proclaim this message of grace. And the Bible says that all of the people sitting around were actually amazed by his words of grace, these kind of gracious words that he uses. And he's telling people about how good God is and how gracious God is. And they're like, that's awesome, that's great. And then he says, and he's gracious to people who aren't religious like you are. And they say, we don't like this. They try to throw him off a cliff whenever that happens. The thing about religion is opposed to the message that Jesus proclaims because religion is about perfection, whereas Jesus is about presence. And the peace that comes not from finding or even pursuing some type of perfection, but knowing the presence of our God. Look at what happens here. They're afraid. They're afraid of these Jewish religious leaders. And so Jesus comes in the midst of their fear, in the midst of their concern about these religious leaders, and he says, peace. Peace be with you. You know, instead of coming and saying, I can't believe you guys are afraid. What's wrong with you? You should just be courageous. You should just act the right way. Just do the right thing. You've fallen so short of where I want you to be and what I want you to do. Jesus instead shows up in the midst of their being afraid and says to them, peace. And this is what Jesus offers to us. This real sense of peace, the knowledge of an absence of conflict and absence of fear and absence of concern, and by his own presence, he brings to us peace with God. Imagine being separated from God and being afraid of that separation and wondering, will I ever be able to do enough to make myself right with him? Like, what if I don't live up to his standards? Now, you look in your own life and think for a moment, have you ever had a time in your life, maybe it's now, maybe it's sometime in your life, where you've been worried about living up to somebody's standards? You may show up this week and you wonder, man, is my boss going to be happy with me? Right? Is she or he going to look at what I'm doing and my performance and think, man, you've fallen short. You haven't done what you're supposed to do. And so do you live with that sense of fear of falling short? Maybe it's a spouse, maybe it's a friend, maybe it's your parents. I know people who are old who still kind of have the sense of, my dad always looked down on me, always talked about how bad I was at things and how I could never live up to what he expected me to live. And you may live that way as well. And that's religion. With regard to God, when we think we can just never live up to his standards because they're so high, he must be looking down on us. I mean, he must feel bad about us. He must think bad things about us. And what Jesus does is to show up and say, peace. Peace with you. Your peace with God isn't dependent on the fulfilling of religious duty. It's instead knowing the presence of God in Jesus. And so as you and I today come to celebrate, the songs that we sing and the words that we read and even the actions that we engage in are not to make ourselves right with God, not to overcome some distance between us and him. Like God is far away from us and he's so much higher than us. When we sing about the holiness of God in the songs that we sang this morning, it's not to say that God is far from us. It's to say the God who has come near to us is this holy and great and majestic God. He has exercised his power for you and for me so that we could be brought into right relationship with him. And so perfection gives way to presence and fear gives way to peace. And that's what you can know today. There may be a lot of things in your life that you're afraid of, but God shouldn't be one of them. You should, even today, hear this word, peace be with you. In fact, Jesus says it twice in the passage. One time wasn't enough. Peace be to you. That's what Jesus is about, and it's what Easter is about. Your fear giving way to peace today. Knowing the presence of God, living in His presence, and experiencing His presence. You may even today look around and see other people who do enjoy the presence of God, and you think, man, what's going on with these people? Are they religious nutcases or what? Those can be two different ways of answering that question. We can still be a nutcase, and nonetheless, we can know the goodness and the presence of our God. But it's not because we're practicing religion. It's not because we're pursuing some type of perfection. It's not that we're trying to exchange our good deeds for God's love and kindness and grace toward us. It's not that God's going to be merciful to us because we know which hand to use at the right time and when to stand up and when to sit down and what magic words we're supposed to use. None of those religious duties are ultimately going to be what bridges the gap between us and God. And so it takes us to the second part of this passage. Jesus not only shows up in the midst of their fear and tells them, look, I know that you're afraid of these religious people, and I get it. I understand. Religious people can sometimes be people that you should be afraid of. You watch the news, and people hold to all sorts of religious positions that cause them to be harmful and hurt other people. Sometimes religious people are the most dangerous people in the world. But people who know Jesus, people who know His peace, are not the ones who are creating war and conflict. They're not out to harm people. They're there to help people. You and I, as followers of Jesus, recognize that what God has brought to us is not just peace in the midst of our fear, but the forgiveness of our sins. You see, the passage begins with them being afraid, and then it moves into this promise of forgiveness. Jesus says to them, look, receive the Holy Spirit, right? The Spirit of God comes into our lives to do what? Not only to remind us of the forgiveness of sins, but to empower us to forgive other people. When people sin against us, rather than holding a grudge and letting that tear our lives up and destroy us from the inside out, because that's what bitterness ultimately is. It's like a poison pill that you take that destroys you from the inside out. You hold bitterness in your heart. You've got a grudge in your heart. It'll tear your life up. It will eat you up and destroy you. And so the forgiveness that the Holy Spirit enables us to give to other people begins with our receiving the forgiveness of our own sins. Now, in order for us to receive forgiveness, we have to recognize that we're sinners, right? That we've sinned against God. Now, if when you hear the word sin, something may come to your mind. You may have some idea of what sin is or what the sins are, like especially the really bad ones that you shouldn't do. The message of the Bible, though, tells us that everybody has sinned in Romans 3, that every person falls short of God's glory, that none of us lives the way that God created us to live. There are things that we do and attitudes that we have and thoughts that we think that are separate from the wisdom of God, right? And because of living according to that foolishness, we're separated from God. And there's this great gulf between us and God that has to be filled. And as we just saw, it's not because God isn't present on our side of the gulf. It's not that He hasn't come to us. It instead is that we continue to run away from Him, and we reject His forgiveness. And so Jesus comes in and He announces to these disciples not only His peace that He gives to them, but His forgiveness that He offers to them as well. That He's the one who offers an opportunity for us to be reconciled to God. By being reconciled to Jesus, because Jesus is God, we know God as well. And we too can be reconciled to Him. Receive this forgiveness. I mean, don't be afraid of what the world might bring at you. Don't be afraid of what your enemies might bring toward you. Instead, be afraid of what you might do to yourself. By refusing to accept forgiveness, God's good and gracious offer to us. And so He says, look, your sins don't have to separate you from God. I love this passage in the book of Isaiah. It says, it is not God's ear, that God's ear is too deaf that He doesn't hear our prayers, or His hand too short that He can't reach out and save us. But our sins separate us from God. And so God comes and He doesn't say, you need to make up for your sins. You need to do good things instead of bad things. He comes and He says, of course you've done bad things. We all know it. We all know that we've sinned. And he says, but if you'll come to me, I'll forgive you. You don't have to retain your sins. There's some of us that we just have a hard time with forgiveness. Not giving it, but receiving it. Some people do have a hard time with forgiving other people, and they hold on to grudges. But receiving forgiveness for many people is difficult. They feel guilty about the sins that they've committed, the things that they have done, the ways in which they have fallen short. And as a result of that, they just don't see themselves as worthy of forgiveness. But God doesn't forgive us because we've earned forgiveness. God forgives us of our sins because he's good and kind and gracious. And so receive from him this forgiveness. But the passage turns a little with a further part of the story when Thomas comes along. Now, poor Thomas, right? This is doubting Thomas. Could you imagine if like 2,000 years from now, somebody still had asked doubting Steve over there, and like 2,000 years from now, people were still talking about you in those terms. I mean, there are a lot of people that use the doubting Thomas phrase without even knowing it comes from the Bible, right? It's this guy, Thomas, here, who is doubting what's going on. So in the story, after the disciples came to Thomas and they said, man, you won't believe this. While you were absent, Jesus showed up, which is a terrible story, right? Terrible. What was he doing? Have you ever thought about that? What was Thomas doing that was so important? He's at home and he's like, well, I really got to get the casserole put together. I don't have time to go and be there with the disciples. Jesus shows up and it's like, I've missed it. I forgot it. I mean, could you imagine if on Sunday morning Jesus shows up and he appears and he's present with us and we stayed home for some other reason? We thought, oh my goodness, I've missed Jesus. And that was Thomas. He missed Jesus showing up. And so he sat around with the disciples and he said, hey, I'm not going to believe that Jesus is raised from the dead unless I see his hands and I see his side. I got to see the scars, where they nailed him to the cross. And if I'll see that, then I'll believe. Because for Thomas, seeing was believing. Right? If I can see, I will believe. Now, there's a backdrop to this that we might not be familiar with of why the seeing the hands and seeing the pierced side is important. It actually comes from the Old Testament, from the book of Psalms, Psalm 22, verse 16. You can write it down. You can look there later. But in that passage, it tells us that the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God, who would come to bring salvation for the world, would be recognized by having his hands and his feet pierced and his side pierced. And so the disciples, having known this then, recognize earlier in the passage when Jesus shows up and he puts his hand up and he shows them his pierced hands, they're like, that's the guy from Psalm 22. That's the guy that was promised to save us. No wonder they rejoiced. Right? They knew the Old Testament. They were looking for this guy to come. And when Jesus shows up and he's like, hey, remember, check this out, they now start celebrating and rejoicing. So Thomas says, well, unless I see them, I'm not going to believe. So even though we sometimes put doubting Thomas down and we make doubting Thomas the bad guy, it's actually understandable why he would be doubting in this passage. It's not that he didn't believe in the resurrection. It's that he wasn't sure that Jesus was who he said he was. He wasn't confident yet that everything that the Old Testament said about the Savior who would come and who Jesus proclaimed himself to be, that he really was that guy. And the resurrection wasn't enough for him. He had to see the scars so he could know he was the one from Psalm 22. And so when Jesus appears, it's great. The Bible says the doors are locked, nobody can get in, and Jesus just shows up. I mean, it's just a reminder to you and to me. I mean, you may put up all sorts of barriers in your life. You know what I mean? You may have all the barriers lined up. God's not getting to me. I'm going to keep myself free from the Lord. I'm going to lock the doors of my house and lock the doors of my heart and lock the doors of my life. And Jesus comes right through them. Right? God shows up in your midst, in your presence, in your life. And today, whatever barriers there are and whatever doors you've locked, just know that Jesus stands here before you. And he says, peace, peace. And when he holds up those hands and you see the scars, it's not just so that you can stick your finger in the hole and know, yep, it's real. It's so you can recognize who he really is and that he's who he said he would be. And who he said he would be in Psalm 22 is the one who would come to forgive us of our sins and to bring life to us. And so the passage ends with this promise of life. John says, look, I told you this story not so you would know cool things from Jesus' life. In fact, I wrote a whole book, he says, not just so you'll know all the cool things that Jesus did. Man, he performed miracles, raised people from the dead. He gave sight to the blind, did all sorts of cool stuff. And I didn't tell you those stories just so you would know it. I told you those stories so that you would know that Jesus was the Son of God. And the reason why that's important is this, and don't miss this. The reason it's important that we know that Jesus is the Son of God is because the Son of God is the one who has promised that he would give us life. That he would give us life. If we trust in him, believe in him, receive him, that he would give us not just life, but eternal life. His own life. Life that comes only from him because he's God. And when we place our faith in Jesus, it's not merely that our fears are removed and replaced with his presence. It's not just that perfection goes out the window and the presence of God becomes what is of most value to us. And it's not just that our sins are forgiven. As wonderful it is to know that whatever failures you have in your life and however you have fallen short, that all that is done away with, past, present, future, it's all ended. But even more, even greater than all of that, is that when Jesus shows up and is present in your life, he brings to you eternal life in his name. So for Thomas, seeing was believing. For you and for me, believing is seeing. You see, if you want to see Jesus this morning, it's not that you need to look to the wooden cross that's on the platform. It's not that you need someone to walk down the aisles and to show you where their hands have been pierced. You have a text of Scripture in which you can see Jesus because you believe in Jesus. And what he has said to us and what he has said to you, I would encourage you right now in this moment to believe. And by believing, you can see. Let's pray together this morning. Father, this morning we thank you for this passage of Scripture. We thank you for the promise that is here that we can go from fear to faith, that we can go from this pursuit of perfection to the presence of God in our lives through Jesus. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins and this promise of eternal life. And I pray that even now, in this moment, that we might not only reflect on eternal life, but that we would know it, and that we would rejoice in it, that we would celebrate it. And I pray that for those who perhaps this morning don't know Jesus, don't know this eternal life, that they would go from believing to seeing, that by trusting in the words of this text and the Jesus who comes to us through these words, that they would see you for who you really are, and having seen you, that they would receive you. And so would you bless our time even now in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. This morning, it may be that you want to talk with somebody about how you can be a Christian. Maybe Easter for you, it's a great day for you to come to know Christ and to place your faith in him. Maybe you feel like sin has separated you from God, and by trusting in him, you can be reconciled to him. You can give up your striving, and you can instead find hope in Christ. Let's stand together, and let's sing. And as we sing this morning, I'd love to talk with you or pray with you. And so you feel free to come even now as we sing together.
God sent his Son. They called him Jesus. Because he lives.
seated for just a moment, and I've got in just a moment some friends that I would like to introduce to you. I don't need that. I'm good. But before I do that, let me remind you of a couple things. One, we would love for you to stick around after the service, and if you go right out into the foyer here, and then there's a hallway to the left, down in the building to the left, our fellowship hall will have just a time of fellowship. We'd love for you to stick around. I know, like, the 9 o'clock service, this is all the people that have got family coming over for lunch. I get it. I understand. You got to get home, got to make sure the roast is done, biscuits get together. I get it. I understand that. So if you got a few minutes, we'd love for you to stick around with us just have a time of fellowship. If I've not met you yet, I would love to be able to meet you today and say hello to you. In addition, look, I understand life is, while Easter is always true, there is a darkness to life that all of us face. And this morning is not rah-rah, right? So it's not, let's pretend, and let's just like cheer each other on and we'll be okay. This is instead of pretend, this is proclamation. And what I mean by that is, despite the fact that there's darkness in the world, and perhaps even darkness in your own life, the light of Jesus that has come to push that darkness aside, to push that darkness back, is as real as anything else you see, hear, or experience today or this week. The living Jesus is as real today as he was when John wrote this and when those disciples experienced that. And don't miss him. Like, don't let the darkness keep you from enjoying the light, right? I know there's darkness, and I know for some of you, man, my heart's heavy for some of you right now because I know of the darkness that you're in the midst of. But know this, the light is greater than the darkness, and it is true. And you may feel like there's only darkness, but know the light, and believing really is seeing. So go today with the joy of the Lord. I'm going to get that. Barry, and come on up here, Barry and Nanette, come stand with them, Al, if you would. I love Barry and Nanette. I've known them for a long time. They're such wonderful people. I'm so glad God has brought them to our church. And we want to bless you guys. You have blessed us already. Barry is really a singer in the family. And no, he doesn't sing at all. So I've tried to get him to. But Nanette, you've seen her. She's already singing, already helping to lead us in worship. And they are such a wonderful couple. They love Jesus and love this church already, and you have loved them. And guys, really want you to know, we want to bless you guys. We want this to be a place that's home for you and that you can grow in Jesus and serve Jesus and walk faithfully with him, and the darkness really can be pushed aside. And thanks for being partners with us in the progress of the gospel. If you'll rejoice with me in their coming to be a part of our church, would you just welcome them this morning? And I think you already have one of these. So I'm gonna let you hold it, though. That way you look pretty. So that's exactly right. So in just a moment, we're going to have, where's Danae? Danae, would you come up here and grab a microphone and pray, if you would, to dismiss us? And before Danae prays, I'm going to ask them to make their way to the back. Would you welcome, make sure you stop by and welcome Barry and Nanette to our church. Let's stand together. And I'm going to let you guys go and head back. And Al's going to walk back with you. And Danae's going to close us in prayer. And don't forget, we do this every Sunday. So if you don't have a church where you worship, we'd love to see you back here next week to come and be a part of all that God is doing here at our church. And we want to enjoy the light. So thank you.
Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the goodness of the gospel and that we get to rejoice and that we've been brought into your family because of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in the life of this church. I pray for those that just are experiencing a lot of darkness in their lives. Lord, I pray that the message of the gospel would just bring them peace today, that peace that comes through Jesus. We praise you, Lord, for all you're doing and all that you will do. I pray that you would bless these families as they go out today. And may the gospel just really take root in all of the hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen.